And I appreciate the kind of reassurance that the gentleman who gave the sermonette spoke of when he said God is very interested in us and our, especially with our emotions, of course. Emotions have its seat in thought, of course. And God wants to know what is in our heart. And he is deeply interested in that. In fact, the title of the sermon today is What is Man That You Are Even Mindful of Him? I added a word there. But that has been posed several times in the Bible, once by Job, a couple of times by David, in a couple of places, and then also by Paul, whenever he quoted David, and simply making the point, well, what is man that you are mindful of him? About 3 weeks ago, there was this announcement where Stephen Hawking and his group is announcing a $100 million hunt for alien life. You may have heard that. On the planes going back and forth, you see a lot of movies, and I saw the movie about Stephen Hawking. And he has been married, he's on his third marriage, and he's supposed to be a very brilliant physicist, astrophysicist, and cosmologist, whatever these things are. And he is able to communicate because he has a sensor in his cheek, you know, he is able then to communicate very with that, believe it or not, and almost perfectly. You can hear him. So it's quite amazing what they're able to do. So he's supposed to be very brilliant individual, which he is. He wrote a book, Brief History in Time. I don't know if you've read it or looked through it. Perhaps most of us simply looked at it on the bookshelf. But it's got some interesting thoughts in it, of course. Now, he has teamed up with a Russian billionaire, Yuri Milner, who held a London news conference and announced their project that this particular Russian billionaire is going to put $100 million into the search for intelligent extraterrestrial life, it says. And Stephen Hawking was one of the featured persons who was behind this, plus other people who do similar things, such as officials in NASA and so on. He says, we believe that life arose spontaneously on Earth, Hawking said at a Monday news conference. So in an infinite universe, there must be other occurrences of life. Of course, one false premise leads to other falsehoods, of course, in this. He says the universe is apparently bulging. This is an astronomer who is a part of the group. Bulging at the seams with the ingredients of biology. And so everybody was really thrilled about this planet that they discovered quite close to the Earth, only 1,400 light years away. You don't even have to worry about that one. But that it seems to have some signs of, or could support life, have moisture, water, and perhaps an atmosphere, and who knows what all. It was at the right place, doing the right things around its particular sun that is very close and similar to ours. Now they think they could try to do this simply because of the how the ability through technology to take the same instruments that they're using to try to find something going on out there. They receive these radio signals or whatever kind of signals that somehow any kind of advanced civilization that can, let's say, put enough energy to amount to a 100-watt light bulb, we will pick it up. Now, there's one problem with that. We haven't picked up anything yet. Now, of course, they're going to keep trying, and they're doing this, and they're trying to communicate with some type of life that is out there on the theory that something must exist out there, and if we've evolved, certainly somewhere else, somebody else had to evolve, And so off we go. Now, of course, you and I understand, and we can be very safe in making the prediction that they are not going to be finding intelligent life out there. They're not going to be receiving those kinds of messages. They do feel that if we do find intelligent life out somewhere out in the universe, that it will change the way we view ourselves. And so they're going to do a more intense search. Now, they will not find the kind of life that you and I have found to exist, because there is intelligent life, as the record that we have here for us today exists in what it calls heaven, which people say is out there somewhere, but they don't know where it is. Now, some few people, and I would suspect it's primarily the people who are right here in this room, have had experience with that intelligent life. You would even call it close encounters with another kind. I hope you would have a close encounter. The closer the encounter, the better that you would have with this particular life that is out there. Now, they won't find this simply because they're looking for it in the wrong place. Let me just briefly say here in that John 4:24, God is spirit. Okay, God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. It's not exactly truth that they're looking for, and they don't understand spirit. Science will never discover spirit. They see evidence of it, but they won't recognize that because it has no physical cause. It cannot be detected by the five senses. You do not detect or understand spirit through the five senses, unless one would physically appear, which has been done in the past, but that is in the annals of the word that we have here before us, quite a rare thing. But you should know that God is spirit, God does exist, that you deal with him in the spiritual realm. And what is so amazing is that you were made to be able to deal with this intelligent life in or on the spiritual realm, in the spiritual realm or the spiritual plane or God plane, as we have described it in the past. I want to go to Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1. I do have quite a bit to bring to you today, and I appreciate your pastor giving me the unusual permission, of which sometimes they don't give me permission, but I do it anyway. But I think he knows the way I do things sometimes. Therefore, we must give the more earnest heed to the things we have heard, Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1, lest we drift away. Now, this is a very interesting chapter here. Matter of fact, the whole book of Hebrews is absolutely fascinating. But he talks about drifting away. We should ask the question, drifting away from what? For if the word spoken through angels proved steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? And so right here is implied, if not said directly, that there is the existence of life beyond humans that is very deeply involved with humans on this earth, mankind as we've come to say it, on this earth. And you have the opportunity to have a relationship with him or not. That's the person's individual choices. And a person can search for God, can find God, if they so choose, and if God will then permit or allow them to have a relationship with him, which God just may. The point is, we do have someone who is very deeply involved. And so we have evidence of it when it says the word spoken through angels. All right, now, there, of course, the anthropologists try to say, well, this is all something man has devised, and has written down for us. You can't prove anything, but what we have is the very word of God. We understand that. We believe that. It's been proved over and over again, and we'll get into some of that proof a little bit later on, but the biggest proof is the fact that you have come to know and understand the great Creator God, the intelligence that is in the heavens, who is focused right here on this earth. You have come to know Him in a spiritual way, and that you see the evidence of it in your life. And Bob in the sermonette spoke to that point, and that we have God then dealing with a person's thoughts, dealing with a person's emotions, leading a person, directing a person, comforting a person, giving encouragement to a person, holding out hope for that person, having letting that person know that there is a purpose and a goal, and all of these things are there and made for man and given to man. Now, if you want to get rid of God, then you're open then to any other kind of idea you want to try to deal with what we're dealing with here on this earth. And it's hard to do. And of course, he spoke to that. It's very, very difficult to do. And we have the opportunity, those of us right here in this room, to have that relationship with one who himself is so mindful of man. So we're going to cover some things today. I want to get into that. So how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed to us by those who heard him? So we have a salvation here. Okay, now if you don't believe in God, if you believe that somehow that we may have some intelligent life that has evolved out there, you don't understand what salvation is. Now, if I was Mr. Hawking and I was in the condition that he's in, I would kind of look for something bigger than me. Now, I mean, that's just my thought on the matter. And you might start thinking the same thing. I was talking to a gentleman. I met a gentleman just before church. He's got Parkinson. Well, I mean, look, if you don't have God, what do you got? Because man's not going to come to your rescue on this. And all the intelligence life, and I kind of wondered about this intelligent life that they're talking about here. Why are they searching out there for intelligent life? I got a feeling deep down, and they haven't really said it outright, that they're a little bit disappointed in whatever we call intelligent life here. And so some of these things that we deal with, man is not going to offer you that the solution that you're looking for. And one day it's just simply going to run out. We know that. And there's not going to be the ability to save ourselves coming or sourced from man's capacity to do so. It's just simply not going to be there. Now, there is something here that he is doing, which is you just simply are not going to find in this way, right here in the second chapter, in any other writings of any other philosophy or any other religion, is simply non-existent. They got a lot of screwy ideas, but you're not going to find this for the simple reason they have not believed that, first of all, there is a creator, and if there is a creator, he's intelligent. It's got to be intelligent, and not only that, it's purposeful. There's got to be a reason for it, and then he's also one who, if he has that reason, it has to do with a relationship that he wants to form with the people who he has created, and he wants to go somewhere with this. And it is beyond us and our capability of being able to achieve that. So if we neglect so great a salvation, we're talking about salvation. We're talking about deliverance. Deliverance from what? Let me make this real clear to us. You're going to die one day. Salvation is deliverance. That's the Old Testament meaning for the word salvation, deliverance. You got to be delivered from this. And we have to experience this kind of salvation. It was first begun to be spoken by the Lord, confirmed to us by those who heard him. God also bearing witness both with signs and wonders, with various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit, according to his own will. So he's backed this up with evidence for people who saw that, and it's been passed on down to us. And there's a lot of other evidence about that, about what happened to, first of all, Jesus Christ, and the fact that he died, and the fact that he was resurrected, and he appeared to his disciples. And you have those who actually believed him to the point of death and spread that same message around. And almost an unbelievable message. Somebody first of all, came from the heavens, appeared on this earth as a baby and born of a virgin by the name of Mary, a young girl, and then came to be who we understand the Son of God, who begat God, and he's called God, in the womb of Mary, came to this earth for some 30-odd years, and was then put to death by man, but remained in the grave for 3 days and three nights and was resurrected, and then we have proof, and we go from there. See, there was some basic proof here as to why you and I are here, and why we understand this, and we've listened to eyewitness accounts, and it has been carried on down to us, and you got to simply believe and understand that word, and you can't neglect it. You can't neglect the promise. You can't neglect the purpose that's here. So he says, how are you going to escape? How will you escape? That's the question. How? I can't escape. It's inevitable as to what my end will be. Now, I understand I got to be delivered. Let's make that point. Now, verse 5, for he has not put the world to come, of which we speak. This is very interesting here. He has not put the world to come. There is a world to come. We live in a particular age right now. What you see is only temporary. And it's going to pass on then to another age, which is called the world to come. Now, then it says, of which we speak. That is the nomenclature of the message that we have been given. And that is, he is, that is the gospel of the kingdom of God. That's what it's called. Now, you can say a lot of things about that, as long as you put it within that frame. And because that tells you the reason for it. Jesus Christ died. He rose again from the dead. That's a part of the gospel, but it is not the gospel message of itself, because he came so that what is talked about as a part of that kingdom of God message can actually come to pass. It's going to come to pass for you. So there's a reason why he did that. Jesus Christ did not come. Let me change that around. I'm not saying that correctly. The world, the earth, the universe was not created just so Jesus Christ could come and die. That's not what he did that for. He created the universe and he created man to do what? To achieve a great and wonderful purpose. And so for man to achieve that wonderful purpose, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, had to come and die. So you got to put it within a particular frame and understand that. You can't change the terms here. You can't change the terms of reference or the definitions. And so he says right here, the world to come of which we speak, and over again, Paul spoke of the kingdom of God, and then he also went on to speak of the means by which we're going to achieve the kingdom of God, and that is through Jesus Christ and everything we might say about him. But the world of which we speak in subjection to angels. You know, the world today is in subjection to angels today. Not the good angels. The world today is in subjection to the other side, the dark side, so to speak. God permitted that. He was already here before man was put on this earth. He created man, put him in a garden, put him on this earth, and Satan was already here. And so many of the angels with him, they were already here. And if man then, who had the capacity, which we're going to see in just a moment, which is one of the most amazing things I hope we'll find out today, then listen to him, listen to what he had to say, and then believed him, and then was deceived by him, led by him, and to adopt certain ideas and philosophies which were not of the Creator, then what you have is a world then made up of humans who in fact do not have self-rule, but are in subjection to angels. Okay, let's make that clear. We made that clear. That's one of the most important things to understand, that the world today is in subjection to angels, the wrong kind. Now, you may not like the fact that you and I have to live in this. but we do. Now, this is what we deal with, of course. And we have to reconcile ourselves to that, and he does so in many ways to help us to reconcile that we have to live in a world in that's in subjection to angels who have themselves turned against God and who chooses to defy God and turn against God and give a lot of ideas and thoughts and concepts and philosophies and teachings that are just completely against God. Now that, yes, we got to live in that. Okay, that's a fact of life. And a lot of the Bible, and once again, if I can refer back to the sermonette that was given, we have to reconcile ourselves to that with what that does to us, the effect that it has on us, and the fact that we have to live in this kind of a world. So the world to come now is going to be it's a different proposition. It's not going to be in subjection to angels. And so he comes down to say, okay, now who's this going to be in subjection to? How's the next age going to be ruled or dealt with? So one testified in a certain place, what is man that you are mindful of him? Or the son of man that you take care of him? Okay, well, what is man? This is a good question here. And it is a lot to be said about this one particular question. You have made him a little lower than the angels, he tells us. And this is quite extraordinary when you understand what man is. And let's just spend a few minutes on that. It says here, he have made him a little lower than the angel. What does this mean? He's answering the question, well, what is man? I find this extraordinary that we have man what does he mean? What way is he lower than the angels? He said, you've crowned him with glory and honor. We look around, some of us may come up with the conclusion today that man is not, I mean, what do you mean crowned with glory and honor? I don't see a lot of glory and honor there in man and the way we're going and the way things are happening and what we do to each other, what man's inhumanity to man seems to defy the idea that we're being crowned with glory and honor, but we have. And so in what way? And set him over the works of your hands. And so we have then a superior being that was created at some point, at some place. And it says you have put all things in subjection under his feet. For in that he has put all in subjection under him, he left nothing that was not put under him. But now we do not yet see all things put under him. Well, that's right, we don't. The world to come is not under man yet, but it's going to be. Now, but right now, it's a different story. So what does it mean that he made man a little lower than the angels? Man occupies a particular place in God's creation. He has a glory, he has an honor that the rest of creation does not have. Now, a little lower than the angels has more to do with the mode of existence. That is, we're subject to die. Angels aren't. They're spirit. However, you can communicate with angels. You can communicate on a certain level in a certain plane with angels. Men do it all the time. Look at the state we're in. They communicate with the angels that have this world into subjection. That's why the world is going in a certain way. And that's the only way you can explain that. So there are spiritual causes here. And so man does think on a certain plane, on a certain level. Now man also has the capacity to have a relationship with God. Yes, he does. And I say man. Now there is a slight difference. Because there's a certain ways that people who have God's spirit, that's an additional spirit, who have a relationship with God in a special way. But any person has the mind, has the capacity to understand the thoughts of God. Yes, he can. And it doesn't matter who you talk, they have the capacity. I'm not saying they do it. I'm simply, they have the ability to do this. And so we are created on a level to have a relationship with God. Adam and Eve could have had a wonderful relationship with God if it had kept going. They still had a relationship with God. Cain had a relationship with God. So did Abel. God came down and spoke to Cain, before he killed Abel, and he's talked about sin, he talked about anger, he talked about letting it get the better of you, and you understand the road you're going on, and this is what's going to happen if you keep going down the same road. He told Cain this. Cain was a sinner. Cain, he had little respect for Cain in terms of his offering, and because Cain was into something else. He was a very inward sort of an individual, perhaps narcissistic, and he wanted a certain position. And so these are spiritual issues that were at variance with God. But God was able to converse with him on a level that spoke of such things like anger. Okay. He could also communicate with Abel about such things as love. Appreciation, worshiping the true God and trying to seek the true God and his purpose. Sure, he could speak to Abel on that level. Cain, who was on the dark side, could still speak to God on such things, and God warned him about certain things. So here's what I'm saying. Man was created to have the capacity and the ability to communicate with intelligent life above, the most intelligent life there is, not the same IQ, we're not even talking about that, but we're talking about such things on the in the area of love, joy, peace. They could understand such concepts. They could also understand concepts such as hate, greed, and violence. These are all spiritual issues. And so man can communicate with God on the spiritual plane. Man was created that way. And so when he's created a little bit lower than the angel, simply means in form and in the mode of existence, man is like the flower of the field. He's going to fade. He's going to die. Angels don't. They will live forever. But we can communicate on a level on spiritual matters. Good or bad spiritual matters. Hate is a spiritual matter. You have to understand that. Anger is a spiritual matter. Greed, lust is a spiritual matter. These are spiritual matters. Do you understand that? And if you start going down that road of sin, you are dealing in spiritual issues. Jesus Christ made it very, very clear that murder, adultery, lying, for instance, in the Sermon on the Mount, are spiritual issues. Aren't there spiritual issues? We have the capacity to understand those spiritual issues. You and I were made to think and to understand and to comprehend on a God plane. Okay. Now don't ever minimize that. You have that capacity, you have that ability to do that. And so when we ask the question, what is man that you are mindful of him? It's not a very difficult proposition to understand, in that you and I can communicate with God on a level in which we can have that kind of relationship, not only with each other, on a spiritual level. And I hope that our relationship with each other is on a spiritual level, that we understand the spiritual principles that's going to allow us to have good relationships with each other. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes in marriage we don't. And things begin to fall apart, but we're offered and we're given that capacity to have that kind of relationship with each other, and we're given that capacity, and I don't know if that's quite the right word. Capacity means the largeness of it, but let's say the ability, I think perhaps is a better word, to have that relationship then with God. Now, so it goes on to say, now man is not complete, of course. it doesn't, man has not reached his potential. There is much more that he has in mind for him. He says in verse 9, but we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels. That can be taken in two different ways. Actually, lower for a little time. That's the way some people say, but it doesn't, it has more to do with that. He was made a little lower simply because he could die. He could suffer. He could experience such things as temptation in sin. But he could experience that. Now, so can angels experience temptation? Now, that's an interesting thought. Go away and think about that one for a while. But angels are angels. That's the way they were created. And they've made certain decisions based upon what they knew and believe what God told them. And angels are angels. Now, man's a little bit different story. Man can be tempted. And a little lower, okay, in that sense. Now, we're not talking about a reduction in the capacity to have that relationship. We're not talking about that at all. For the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor. So he was crowned with glory and honor too, like man was. Perhaps in a little bit a better way, of course, that he, by the grace of God, might taste death for everyone. That is that's a glorious thing, what he did, to taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, and bringing many sons to glory. And so we're getting down to the purpose of why he put man on this earth, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through sufferings. And so now we have the captain of their salvation, the one by and through whom are all things, now was made flesh. Now, this is quite, once again, an extraordinary example of man coming in contact in a very special way with intelligent life in the heaven. One came from heaven. One came to this earth. He became flesh. For both he who sanctifies and those who are being sanctified are all of one, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren. And so he was made a little lower, became flesh, so that we can be his brethren. So he became of the mankind, right, still had his relationship with the God kind in every sense, in every way, and even giving us an example as to how man, us, can have that same kind of relationship and deal with the elements that are in this world in which we have to live. And so we have yet further explanation here as to who man is, that he is mindful of us. Okay. So, you know, this earth has been described among the stars of the universe. Doug, if you don't mind, I have the first slide here I want to show you. This earth has been described among the stars in the universe as one speck of sand on all the beaches of the world.
Life,
not quite there yet. The earth has been described in the whole universe like a speck of sand in all the beaches of the world. Here is a shot of a galaxy, or a picture of our galaxy, which is similar to our Milky Way. You know how many stars in that Milky Way? It's about 100, some of you know this already, 100 billion stars in that Milky Way. Now, that's a lot. We're getting up to national debt sort of figures here, by the way. Yeah, 100 billion stars in this particular galaxy of the universe. Now, They have an estimate, if we can have the other slide, which is not the best slide, but the best one Google Images could come up with, of these galaxies. Now, these are galaxies. This is a shot. You've seen this shot perhaps many times from the Hubble telescope that was taken of one little spot about so big, you know, out here in the sky. That's about all it was. And they took that shot, and you got 100 galaxies in it. Okay, maybe more than that. I don't know who sits around and counts these things. But these are galaxies. It's not stars. These are galaxies. Now, so if you kind of scoped out the entire universe with a telescope, which of course they're trying to do, let's say you want to take a look at the Milky Way in terms of the how many actual stars that are there, 100 billion stars, it is estimated that as a rough estimate, there are 10 what? Trillion galaxies in the universe that they know of. That's it, that they know of. All right, what's beyond that? Well, I don't know, we don't have telescopes go that far. But it's an expanding universe. Who knows what is out beyond that? But this is what we've come up with so far. All right, so this comes down then to 100 octillion stars. That's one with 29 zeros. Okay, this is a lot of matter. It is matter. Gaseous matter and matter, solid as we know it today. And our sun is made up of certain elements that just produce energy. Now, this is a very interesting concept here that we're trying to develop nuclear energy today. This is not a science thing, but it has a little bit to do with it, because we need to understand who is God, that he is mindful of us. This kind of puts it a little bit in perspective. In that, we're trying to stop Iran from producing, what are they producing? Is it some kind of uranium, plutonium kind of derivative or something like that? So make it so unstable that in a very small unit, they can release the energy that's in just a very small amount of that and then form an atomic bomb. I don't know how much was actually in the original atomic bomb or even hydrogen bomb, what you have here is an enormous amount of energy packed into some very unstable atoms. Okay, everybody, you understand this. This is the way it works. But you have to take other unstable, or let's say less stable atoms, such as uranium-238, plutonium, and so on, and they have to do kind of stuff with them that they've got all over the country in Iran, producing the type of substance that can, once it's bombarded in just the right way, can cause those atoms to, those very, very unstable atoms, to release that energy and to form a, an explosion that is very, very destructive. I simply want to point out that it doesn't take much matter, albeit unstable matter in that way, to produce this or release this kind of energy. Now, it has been estimated. I don't know who does this estimation, but I'll just tell you right now that this is what some of the people out here who do this kind of thinking. There's enough power in, let's say, matter that is in a loaf of bread. That is all, if the atoms in that loaf of bread and were all released through atomic, is it fusion? Sorry, I may not have my facts right on that one. But through somehow that is released into energy, that there's enough energy in a loaf of bread to obliterate the Earth completely. Wouldn't there be anything left in it? Okay, that's the kind of energy that we got here. All right, so the chair you're sitting on is a very explosive item, but it's all held together. You don't have to worry about this. And so are you. because what you are made of is you're all held together in a very in a very important way. As a matter of fact, let's go there to let's see if I can locate this particular scripture. I want to Colossians 1:17. Now it talks about the invisible God, and he is invisible. You don't see God. There's evidence of God, but you don't see God, you don't feel God, you don't smell God, you don't taste God, you don't hear God. Okay, you don't have to hear. Some people did hear God, some people saw God. But that's as I said, very, very rare. Colossians 1:17, he is before all things, and in him all things consist, or, as the New King James says, hold together, just held together. Everything's held together. So you don't have to worry about yourself. It's all being held together. And so all of these atoms function in a certain way, and they come together, they form certain molecules and substances. And if you didn't, and they operate in a way by law in which you can have such things as chemistry. And you have physical bodies in relation to other physical bodies. You have physics, okay? You have a lot of other science that goes on like this where people can understand simply how things work, and it is rather complicated. But he says right here, all things hold together. He says that in another place too. Let me just give you a reference. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. All right. Now, let's ask this. The theory that they used to have was the steady state theory. Remember years ago when we went to school? Well, you probably don't remember that. I remember it was a steady state theory. That is, the universe always existed. There was never a time when it didn't exist. Well, they said, no, that doesn't work, because they see things happening out there that it had to have some kind of a beginning, and so they come up with what they call the Big Bang Theory. All right, now you've got a TV show named after that. That's how popular it is. So you have, it all came into existence at a certain point, at a certain time. Now, they did reason in their limited minds, which they can do, that, look, this had to have a starting place. And so it had a starting place. And so we have all of the matter in all of the universe. Don't have a picture up here again. All of the galaxies in all of the universe that's out here all came into being at a certain point. And that was around, 16.8 billion years ago. When I went to school, it was around 4 billion, but they've changed that. Things took a little longer. And of course, the harder things are to imagine as to how they got to where they are today, you got to keep adding billions of years to make it so. Okay, we understand things like that. But it points out this, that we have something that had, if we can call it energy, was able to transform this into matter, because he's going to create man one day and make him physical, a physical creation, then to understand with the mind of God. And so God creates from what? Within himself, the entire universe, which, of course, which is an enormous expenditure of energy. And so we have the universe of which man is a part. And you're not going to find man anywhere else. You're not going to find life anywhere else. He's dealing with man. He's dealing with man on a certain speck, a grain of sand, in the vast stretch of what we call the universe, and we're asking the question, what is man that you are mindful of him? And we start off with the fact that the world then is not going to be in, of which we speak, the world to come, is not going to be in subjection to angels, but it's going to be in subjection to man. So we could perhaps stop the sermon here. But we won't. Now, says in chapter 12, I'm sorry, 2 verse 12 of Hebrews, to continue on. I will declare your name to my brethren. In the midst of the assembly, I will sing praise to you. And again, I will put my trust in him. And again, here I am in the children whom God has given me. So we now have humans called children, children of God. Inasmuch as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same. Now, God can do anything. People say, well, how can somebody who has eternally existed, who is called God, become flesh? This is not a hard concept to understand, because there had to be two of them, and one had to do it to the other. This is not a, you know, that's the only logical explanation you can come up with. And through death, he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. So death shouldn't be a problem. He's saying, for us, making the kind of choices that we need to make. For indeed, he does not give aid to angels. Did you know that? He does not give aid to angels. Angels don't need aid. Humans need aid. Now, this is quite a revelation here. But he does give aid to the seed of Abraham, so he narrows it down. To the people, then, who he is now dealing with. And he gives aid to them. That's in the first stage, if I can put it that way, of God dealing with us. It is now, now refers to the seed of Abraham. But I were answering the question, what is man? Any man can have a relationship with God, if God would allow him to, and if a man would perhaps seek God, and God would then grant him that access, he can have that relationship with him and deal with him, because he is a very special creation, a little lower than the angels, but a very special creation nonetheless. And so here's what I want to say to you, if there's no other point to be learned from the lesson today, is that, who are you? Now, what, in other words, what are you? That's the question, isn't it? What is man? And that you have the ability to have a relationship with the eternal and almighty God. Now, that's not something that we need to kind of just pass over. But he has made us this way, in such a way where we can think like him. If we get in contact with him, we can understand truth and absolute truth. If we get in contact with him, we can understand his purpose. We can understand where he's going. We can understand the future. We have the capacity to create. We have imagination. We have the ability to choose. Yes, we do. Animals do not have the ability to choose. They are what they are. And we learn this when we understand what man is, in that we are of, while we are mankind, in our thinking, in our capacity, we are of the God kind. I'm not talking about the potential. That's a different matter, which we'll cover in just a moment. Potential is another thing. But now, right now, you have the ability of choice. You understand the concept of right and wrong. Yes, people have that ability to have a conscience, to understand right and wrong. And so in this way, you and I think like God. Or we can turn against God and we can think like the devil. But either way, we're having a relationship with spirit beings. Think about that. All right. So, man can think on the God plane. He made them in his likeness and in his image, meaning not just an inferior look-alike, but the capacity to understand the physical creation, but so much man still doesn't understand, He can come to right conclusions as to what he sees and exercises the choices that he has, or and not come to right conclusions if he so chooses. But make no mistake, he has that capacity to communicate and think on the God plane. Not that he's complete, he's not. But man is ranked right up there with the Elohim. Matter of fact, sometimes the idea of a man and positions of a man is referred to as Elohim. That's in the Bible, I'm not making that up. So man roams the earth. He muses over what he sees. He uses it. He builds civilizations. He devises ways of life. He creates religion. Man is a very special creature or creation. So he speaks of neglecting salvation, but we have to ask then, where is God going with all of this? And this is when we read about Jesus, who has come to this earth and suffered being tempted as we all are. And he gives aid to us to begin to think the way he does. So, perhaps the obvious question would be at this point is this. If God is mindful of man, how much is man mindful of him? Now, I don't know what goes on in your mind. That's something you have to be concerned about. As to, all right, how mindful am I of God's things, matters that belong to God, God's purpose, who and what God is, and to understand who he is. We get really bogged down in the small things sometimes, and we forget who we are. And we are made in the image of God. And right now we see, perhaps it's sensitive, I hope you're not sensitive to this, but we're involved in race relations today in almost every country. This is quite amazing how we get bogged down and we begin to demean and lower the estimation of other people simply because they are a different race. And in some races might even act that way. Let me put it this way. All races act in a way which are not according to God. Okay, are we willing to accept that? That's because we don't know who we are. Paul is trying to answer that question. Do you know who you are? Do you understand God is mindful of you? Now, 4:15. We do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. So we have a human being here. And he did not have special abilities humanly to be without sin. He understood who God was. And he was able to act in that way. And so he lived a life without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Notice this, brethren. Let us come boldly to the throne of grace. He says this twice in the book of Hebrews for the simple reason he wants you to understand who you are and that you have access to the throne of grace. Why the throne of grace? Because you need it. All right. We have to have that. That's why it's called the throne of grace. And hopefully you can discuss such issues before the throne of grace as, what did Bob say in his sermonette? Forgiveness. What an amazing concept. What an extraordinary idea as forgiveness that you can have a reasoning session with God who says, come, let us reason together now. You have the capacity for reasoning. Yes, you do. You ought to use it in the right way. And to discuss the matter of grace. What does that mean? That means, first of all, an acknowledgement that you're not everything you ought to be. And you never will be. So you got to have something that covers this. And so you have a throne of grace, which you are allowed to come in front of and before and express yourself in the deepest and indeed emotional way that you see fit before this very throne. And guess what happens? You get a hearing. Okay. Okay, we're asking the question now, what is man that you're mindful of him? And he comes boldly to the throne of grace, as Jesus did. Jesus did. He came to the throne of grace, that he found mercy and grace to help in time of need. Jesus needed mercy? Yes, he did. He had to have help. He had to have aid. Doesn't give aid to angels. He gives it to humans. And you got to go there and get it. Okay. He created you to have a relationship with him, to be able to go to him and receive and accept that aid which comes through the gift, grace of him. This is not hard. Not rocket science, by the way. It's a very simple concept. But the devil doesn't want you to even remotely believe that you have any kind of a look-in with this throne of grace. That's what he told Eve. He says, you can't trust him. And so he's turned man against God, his very creator. Chapter 5, verse 7. Who in the days of his flesh, when he had offered up prayers and supplication with vehement cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death? How could he die? He had to be made flesh. And was heard because of his godly fear. We need to really be mindful of God and who he is. And it's only when you know who he is that you know who you are. And if you don't know that, the devil will come along and try to tell you. Having been perfected, he became the author of eternal salvation to all who obey him. So he became a little lower, showing that God, while he has the capacity to have a relationship with us by lifting us up to have access to the throne of grace, he then comes down to us. Now we really get God when that happens. You get God? Yes, you do. When that happens. So he becomes flesh. Now, 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 6. Let me see if I can bring this to a conclusion here as rapidly as I can. Which may be beyond human capacity, but we'll see. We speak, verse 6. However, we speak wisdom among those who are mature, yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. That's what we have to understand. But we speak the wisdom of God in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God has ordained before the ages for our glory. So that's what Paul spoke and tried to help people to understand there's a lot more beyond our human existence, which none of the rulers of this age knew, for had they known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Let me tell you something, they don't have a clue. For it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor have entered into the heart of man. Stephen Hawking doesn't get this. Has not entered into the heart of man the things which God has prepared for those who love him. So, You enter into a relationship of love. And rightly so, because you understand who he is and what he is and what he's done. His mindfulness of us invokes love. As Paul said, the love of God compels us, he says. We also read by John, who said, we love him because he first loved us. We read, the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from all sins. Open your Bible to any psalm you want to. It doesn't matter which psalm. Just open any, just and read it. I have some psalms here to read to you, but I won't. Psalm 57, very, very interesting. Any psalm. And you begin to see then a relationship of a person whose eyes have been opened to what God, and has it has entered into his heart, the things which God has prepared for those who love him. And that is a requirement. You got to love him, not mistrust him, not suspect him or be suspicious of him or wonder whether he's going to do what is best for you. You can't go around that way. It's got to be all the way with that relationship. For God has revealed them what? What he has in mind for us. He has revealed them to us through his Spirit, for the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God. So now we have the Spirit of God. What man knows the things of a man except the spirit of man which is in him? Even so, no one knows the things of God except the Spirit of God. So there's some things here about this, about God's Spirit that God can show a man. Hopefully, again, these are the people right here in this room, that he has opened up that person's heart and mind to know what God has prepared for us and what is the very sure thing that he has in store and where we're going. Now, you got to keep asking that question, where is this going and what's the purpose of it? Now, so that's revealed through his Spirit. You understand things of a man, and the things of a man through the Spirit of man. Remember, we defined this years ago, back in the 1970s. Mr. Armstrong understood this and explained it beautifully, that we understand the things of a man, which includes the capacity to understand concepts. Love, joy, peace, faith. All right. And all the ways, forgiveness, I have to include that one, that we understand this. You can understand this. God can get through to a person. That's why God can get through to a person. Because you, while you didn't have the Spirit of God, he could, with his Spirit, start showing you some things you didn't see before. And now you begin to understand them because your Spirit was able to witness with his Spirit, and you're able to comprehend some of this. And if you really wanted to be involved, you allowed his Spirit then to come within you through a deep repentance and a love toward God for what he was willing to do for you. And then you, hopefully, the rest is history. Well, I hope it is for you, that you take it from there. We have not received the spirit of the world. Now, that's still yet another spirit, but the Spirit who is from God. For we might know the things that have been freely given to us by God. You like the word freely? Some people don't. They're not happy people. Freely given to us by God. The things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but with the Holy Spirit teaches, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. I hope you converse with God on matters of love, matters of peace, matters of forgiveness, matters of faith. I hope that's your conversation with him. Okay. Yes, you can say, if you didn't have any bread, you could say, Lord, give us our daily bread, but it takes just as much faith to ask God for bread if when you don't have it, then if you want to turn that into a spiritual thing, well, meaning the Word of God. It's still a spiritual matter that you're dealing with God then on a spiritual plane. The natural man does not receive the things of the Spirit of God. He didn't say he couldn't understand them. It says he doesn't receive them. Notice the words here. He doesn't receive them. For they are foolishness to him, for nor can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. I hope that is the realm in which you and I operate. For he who is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is rightly judged by no one. For who has known the mind of the Lord? That's what Stephen Hawking said. If we look far enough out in the universe, we might find the mind of God. I already know lots of people who already found it. The mind of God. Who has known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ. Let's make sure we do. It denotes those who are governed and influenced by the natural instinct, the animal passions and desires, in opposition to those who are influenced by the Spirit of God. Now, Paul says in the same context, if you want to continue on to chapter 3 and verse 1, that there were some issues here as to what this church of Corinth were doing to themselves. And I, brethren, cannot speak unto you as to spiritual people, but as to carnal, as to babes in Christ. He says, I needed to speak to you on spiritual matters, but you couldn't handle this. I fed you with milk and not with solid food. For until now, you were not able to receive it. Even now, you are still not able. I would take that as a matter of shame if he had said that to us. For you are still carnal, for where there are, and here is how you understand carnality, should be understood in these terms: envy, strife, divisions among you. Are you not carnal and behaving like mere men? That's an excellent translation. Mere men. For when one says, I am of Paul, and another, I am of Apollos, are you not carnal? And Paul is asking the very simple question, do you know who you are? What is man that God is mindful of him? He's offering you and I a wonderful relationship, far beyond anything we would ever get being left to ourselves. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls. And for your attention and for your patience.